You're hard nut to crack.
Am I?
Yeah.
I know, that must be frustrating.
It's hard. And see, this is like, it's, I put everything in my music, and then when people say, like, what's it about? It's like, it's about such personal stuff, and I feel like it's graphically told, you know?
Why should I tell you?
Yeah. But at the same time, I should tell you because I'm putting out this music and people connect to it, and I want those people to know why I write this stuff, and I want to kiss those people and hug them, and like, so, yeah.
I'm here in LA and I'm gonna be meeting up with Banks to talk about her new record, The Altar. I've been super supportive of her music since the very beginning in 2013, so I'm excited to finally meet her in person. It was at the top of 2013 that Banks announced herself to the world via SoundCloud with a little song called Before I Ever Met You. It simmers with angst and perfectly pinpoints the tiny details that make the dissolution of any relationship so crushing. This was followed by a bunch of singles that clearly defined her aesthetic. The palette was dark, the look was minimalist, and the music was pop spiked with modern R&B. On her 2014 debut album, Goddess, she continued to align herself with cutting-edge left-field producers. Meanwhile, her sonic confessionals earned her a legion of fans. Now she returns with her second album, The Altar, a collection which almost improbably goes deeper in. I heard that when you played with The Weeknd, that was actually technically your very first live show in front of people.
Yeah, my show with The Weeknd was like my first real proper show. So it was definitely like, went from 0 to 100 real fast.
Yeah, that's crazy, trial by fire.
Yeah.
How did it feel to get out in front of all those people? I mean, I saw you at Radio City Music Hall.
I mean, it was crazy. It was surreal, it was scary. I had to get used to a million different things, you know, like singing my songs in front of people. They're so intimate and they're so raw and it's like the most vulnerable parts of me. And so that was something to get used to. But I mean, I love it.
London was a pretty formative place for you.
The London EP was like a turning point in my life. You know, I made it in 2.5 weeks and I was meeting all these people for the first time that did what I did and communicated how I did for the first time. You know, like it was the first time I was open about being a musician even. And all of a sudden I was like, whoa, like I'm not this strange creature that can't connect to people. I just didn't find my tribe yet.
And
so that was kind of when I like started finding my tribe.
With this new record, it feels even more intimate, actually, and exposing than the last album.
Yeah.
You did mention that you kind of went through a period of depression and that you were working through some stuff.
You know, there are so many different things that I was confronted with that I had never really gone through before, and I had a lot to process. And I've, you know, I've struggled with depression since I was like 16 or 17, so every few years it hits me and definitely I got hit, you know, when I was in the middle of writing this album. And I think depression is like the stage right before you give birth to something. You know, it's like the universe kind of like trying to pull you back when it knows you're about to like leap forward. And I think that's what it was, because out of that, I wrote this song called Mother Earth, which was a really necessary thing for me to write just as a woman living in this world and this society. And, you know, getting out of that process through my music was, it allowed me to like leap forward. And it's like, you know about Goddess Kali?
No, tell me about her.
She's the goddess of destruction and creation. So it's kind of like with everything destructive comes creation. And that's kind of how I think of depression.
Specifically with Mother Earth, part of the inspiration for the lyrics was the sort of unreal expectations that are placed on women specifically.
You know, my sister recently had a daughter. It's my first niece. I was feeling like I was like in this box, like I was like smushing like the bigness inside of me, like smushing the most colorful parts of me. Like that's how sometimes I feel the society is, what I feel like it does to the most feminine parts of women. I think that like it wants you as small as possible and, you know, to be as like pretty and non-confrontational, and sometimes it makes you think like you can't be fierce and you can't be aggressive and you can't be authoritative. And I think that you know, after my sister had baby Georgia, I started feeling like almost scared for her to grow up and feel that. Like I wanted to shield her from it. Mm. It makes me like emotional talking about that song because I get letters from fans all the time too. Sorry.
No, it's okay.
I get letters from fans that are just like saying how they hate themselves and stuff. And mm-hmm. It breaks my heart because everybody's, you know, women are so powerful and they're so beautiful and I want them to feel that.
Mm-hmm. You do have a really deep connection with your fans. You've allowed them a lot of access to you. Do you ever feel like the pressure, like, I don't know what to do with all these stories or how I can help?
Yeah, sorry.
It's all right.
Like, I run my Instagram and I'll occasionally tweet lyrics and stuff, but I don't think I open myself up more than maybe other people do. It's just like in a different way. Mm-hmm. For me, it just feels like more personal the way that I do it. But it's such like a special thing to have people connect to what I do. My music is the most... It's like if you connect to my music, then you connect to me, and then I connect to you, so.
Yeah. Fuck With Myself was the first single off this record, and it's so bold, mm-hmm. particularly with the video.
Yeah.
And I loved how you had this effigy of yourself. Talk to me a little bit about that song and where the inspiration came from.
I just thought, I do fuck with myself more than anybody else, and I don't give a shit what people think about what I put out because my music is me and like if it's fulfilling me then the people who connect to it I love you and the people who don't that's okay but it doesn't affect me you know and so that's kind of how the song was born. Once I started thinking about really what like fucking with yourself means I started thinking about like my relationship with myself and like how many stages I've gone through and how many different interpretations of what fucking with yourself can be and I've gone through stages where I've been like my own worst bully and that's where some of my songs have come from. And then there are stages where I'm my own biggest support and my own nurturer and my own mother. And I kind of wanted the video to represent that in the most graphic way possible. So I was like, let's make a, you know, I made it with this wonderful, creative, beautiful little alien named Philippa Price. And, you know, we just came up with this concept of, you know, what's more vulnerable than a bald, you yourself bald, you know, and so...
So exposed.
Yeah, and then just like hitting it and licking it and kissing it. And
and then also you're totally naked in it.
And I'm naked, yeah, I'm butt naked. That was a really intense thing for me, like singing that song, I fuck with myself more than anybody else, and looking at your naked body in the mirror with all these people around, it was like, I fully accept you. Like that's what you have to do in moments like that, and it's really empowering. I think everybody should get a fake version of themselves and like beat the shit out of it and see what they feel.
Stare it in the face.
Because it's really, it's emotional. I mean, like seeing what you do to yourself mentally in a visual form, like seeing my face bounce when I hit it, it made me want to not treat myself like that. It made me want to like just nurture myself and like, how would I want to treat my daughter? It was a really like eye-opening thing for me.
What is your relationship like with your body in terms of, I imagine, being in the public eye and, like, having people's comments and, like, it must make you examine yourself in, like, ways that you
I think with that stuff, I've always known that that's how this business is. And I think that as a woman, you grow up with that. I mean, this is my body. This is what helps me walk. This is what helps me have sex. You know, this is the house that I live in. And you have to, you know, love that. And people like to like fragment up women's bodies. It's like we're a one full entity. And if you think, you know, you have to really think of yourself like that in a way where you come with like love and like just appreciate yourself as like a full entity, then I think it like helps you not objectify yourself like that.
Yeah. When did you realize that you could sing?
Well, singing was like secondary to writing.
Okay.
So I started writing when I was like 14 or 15. And then that came with like melodies, and then that's when I decided, like, whoa, that's a thing. Like, you can, like, sing a melody and feel good after.
And 14 or 15 was kind of, there was a lot going on in your life, right? Your parents were divorcing and you were processing a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And that just sort of manifests itself in just writing a lot of journals and...
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was just the time I discovered music. I mean, like, you always need an outlet of some sort, and I definitely do. I'm an intense human, I guess. And that's when I discovered it, around that time.
And what were you like in high school?
I was super social initially, and then the last year I changed and became super introverted.
Why was that?
Just lots of different stuff going on. But I started wearing all black that year.
Oh, really?
Yeah. My outsides reflect my insides.
Oh, shit. Blacker than black.
Yeah, but black isn't all negative, and it's not all, like, dark and depressive. Black is, like, it encompasses every single color that there is. So it's all-encompassing. It's almighty.
Almighty. Where do you feel your most yourself?
In the studio.
Because I always find it, like, a crazy thing, you know, with all these songwriters collaborating with all these other songwriters and producers, and, like, it is such an intimate experience, and you're expected to go into the studio and be like, bleh.
That's why I don't work with, like, I mean, I worked with the same five people on the entire album, and the same thing with the first album. It's too intense. Like, it's like this is intense. Mm-hmm. That's why this job is so intense. Like, people, you know, this is really intense. Like, having to, like, talk about what your music is about, and, like, it's deep. And sometimes people don't take it that way. And so that's what makes this uncomfortable sometimes and scary sometimes. But that's why songs like Fuck With Myself exist in my mind, because it's like, well, this is me, and I fuck with myself more than anybody else, so eat it up.